Hello, everyone. Welcome to today's Skill Up session. My name is Emily Spranger. My pronouns are she, her, and I'm a graduate learning specialist in the Graduate Studies Support Center. We are very thrilled to have Dr. Gary Walker Roberts join us today. Our session is on ensuring inclusivity with APA 7th edition expectations. Dr. Gary will move us into our session briefly. I would like to provide you with a few housekeeping items before we begin. We are recording our session. We have scrolling subtitles going at the bottom. You can choose to enable that for your viewing pleasure. Of course, we want you to use the chat. You're welcome to have conversation in there. And then if you do have questions, please pose them in our Q&A function of the Zoom. I think that about does it, Dr. Gary, for my introduction. And again, everyone, thank you so much for being here today. I introduce you to Dr. Gary, one of our Stanford College Education professors.
Thank you so much, Emily. And it's always great to be here with you. And first and foremost, I want to welcome each and every one of you into our Zoom presentation today from around the world. I think that's just amazing. Like, talk about inclusivity, right? Like, that's just wonderful. I'm going to go ahead and share my presentation now. So let me do the share. Let's go ahead and get started. Hi, everyone. My name is Dr. Gary Walker Roberts, and you can address me as Dr. Gary, and please use the pronouns they, them. I also want to point out to you in this slide that doctor is gender neutral for Ms., Mr., Mrs., and Misters. Wait, oops, Misters isn't really a thing, is it, right? So in our language, we don't have Misters because Mrs. is possessive, but that's a whole other skills up that we can talk about with feminism and also the patriarchy. But if you want to make Ms., Mr., Mrs., and Misters as gender neutral, you can use mix, right? So in writing language, MX period, or in speaking language, mix. So I look forward to presenting to you today. And just like Emily said, I am a professor in the Stanford School of Education, and I proudly work in the Department of Global Innovation, Social Emotional Learning, and Education Technology. So without further ado, I'd like to set up today's session, which we are going to have some goals and activities for the presentation, which is titled Ensuring Inclusivity with APA 7th Edition Expectations. We all love to feel included and also feel a sense of belonging. So those are the goals for today. We're going to define inclusivity and see what it looks like in action through the lens of the American Psychological Association, APA 7th edition, which we all know guides our requirements in our scholarly writing. We'll practice how to ensure inclusivity as it's incorporated into scholarly writing, whether it's in your courses or in your dissertation and there beyond. So if you become a published author after your dissertation, write some articles. I actually know that we do have a newly authored student in the group today. We'll talk about later, but we'll definitely congratulate her. We will also then move into where to find the best resources in the Academic Success Center. And I also would like to have a roundtable discussion where we all can jump in and teach one another and give resources that we may have. And with that said, though, I really want to set up a safe zone. This is a safe space for each and every one of us. So what that means is really listening and understanding, listen through empathy. Like if we go back to the social emotional learning, we want to be empathetic. We want to put ourselves in other people's shoes, but we also want to understand that we all don't have the same experiences. We bring different experiences to the table. And actually, we had a great, wonderful session yesterday on intersectionality, which, you know, really pulls together multiple identities that we all, have and what experiences we have through our long lived life. So without further ado, I'd like to go to the next slide and define inclusion. inclusivity. So inclusion is about creating a space where everyone is welcome to be who they want to be without fear of judgment or retaliation. And that is very, very important as I sit here proudly and wear the new NCNU t-shirt for Pride, which says at the bottom, be the whole you, right? So be proud to be the whole you at NU. And that's amazing because, again, we all come from different backgrounds. We all have different identities. And when we create that safe space and that inclusive space, we all then can learn from one another and push society forward. I wanted to give you a little bit of a historical context of gender-neutral pronouns. So I'm sure everybody in the room is very familiar with he, she, him, her, right? Which are the binary. But did you know that the oldest gender pronoun in the English language was the singular they? Yeah, right. So it's pretty amazing. And what happened is in medical texts that the doctors were using they, them pronouns for everybody to be inclusive. So they didn't use the binary he, she, they, them. However, it became very clear that grammar was on the table when it came to the linguistics and the English scholars. So it was the English scholars and the linguists that made they grammarly incorrect in scholarly writing. Now, I want to go back in history a little bit about that. So if you think about who were the agents over language, whether it be written or verbal, it was cis, straight, white, rich men. So if you think about that, if they, those men, felt comfortable in the binary system as a man using he, him, then they didn't really put themselves in other people's shoes or apply empathy to others to see that they don't fit in the binary and feel uncomfortable or unsafe if they are misgendered. So I think it's very important that we think about that, that language has rules, but the rules were made by cis, straight, white men. And as an English master's myself from Arizona State University, I love to be able to challenge people and to also ask other English scholars to really look at and stop saying that it's grammarly incorrect to use they, them. It's not. Rules are made to be broken. Rules are made to evolve. And that's exactly where we are at this point in time, is in that evolution. However, the APA has said that we must use they in certain circumstances to make sure that our scholarly writing is in compliance with an inclusive tone. So did you know that English speakers' dissatisfaction with the binary gendered language was documented in the 18th century and then specifically started to have uprising in 1795. I was blown away by this. I was like, wow, after learning the history of gender pronouns and the binary system, and when the colonization of Turtle Island, which is known as North America and South America today, is that the colonizers brought the binary gender system with them. Also, you could look back to Native American history, Hawaiian history, and understand that there were multiple genders and that the people in those systems thrived, they felt included, and they had a very special place in society. And additionally, we could look at other languages. You could look at the Japanese language, Tagalog, Creole, where there is no gender noun in the pronouns in the language. But the Romance languages, such as French, Spanish, and now English, certainly have a specific gender for the language. They has a long history, as you could see, as a gender pronoun. And the word they, again, became under scrutiny and under the microscope from social conservatives, colonizers, and linguists who were sticklers that they wanted to put the rule in, that we had to be grammarly correct in our in our language. I also want to talk a bit, go back to the intersectionality piece. As you can see at the bottom of my screen, gender intersects all of the social justice groups that we fight for. So DACA, immigrants, other cultures, Black Lives Matters, so all races, people with seen and unseen disabilities, multiple languages, which we just talked about, and also faith-based institutions. So, you know, gender really intersects all areas in our life. And that's why it's so important that we really have this discussion and that we ensure that we are making sure that our writing is inclusive. I always talk about the why, right? Why is this important? And if you fit perfectly in the binary system with your identity of pronouns being he, him, or she, her, then sometimes it's a little bit more difficult to understand, like, why is it important? Because it feels right for me. And I feel comfortable in society, and I feel comfortable in my writing using these pronouns. But if you take a look at it from a different angle, and that's what I'm here to do for you today, is I want you to understand that when you misgender somebody, you could be, number one, putting them in a very dangerous situation. So that's first and foremost. Also, secondly, it could be uncomfortable for a person. And also, it could be a microaggression. So if you see in the center of the screen, 26% of LGBTQIAA plus students report that their biggest problem is feeling accepted at home or by family. Also, they have a lot of trouble at school with bullying and a fear of being outed or being open. So they're in the closet. 22% of non-LGBTQ youth say their biggest problems are trouble with class, exam, and grades. So even before we get into education, we're talking about family life, right? And I think you could look around the country and see many bills and laws being passed that have really are sliding the LGBTQIAA plus advocacy backwards. And so it's time to seize the moment and really understand, why is that happening? Why are people uncomfortable? And why is it important and needed? One of the people that I always talk about when I do presentation is Ronan. And Ronan was from Sacramento. And as you could see, Sacramento CBS News reported that students called Ronan gay because of his role on the cheer team. So we have specific gender assignments when it comes to certain roles. I mean, colors, names, et cetera. We can have that discussion. But just because Ronan was on the cheer team, he was bullied and called gay, and he ended up committing suicide. He was 12 years old. So these have real implications. These have real consequences when we misgender or we use language, weaponized language against another person. So that's the grim, the reason why, the problem. But here's the celebration, right? Like with inclusive language. So if you see in the third column on my PowerPoint presentation, this is an actual quote that a student from National University wrote to me after they watched my welcome video and read my welcome letter. They said, when I saw you were writing using gender pronouns, I was at ease. I could be myself in your class. It is refreshing to collaborate with someone who gets it. So I think that's very important and powerful, right? So if you're using language, gender neutral language in your writing, it will signal to somebody that, oh, I can feel comfortable with this person. I feel a sense of belonging. As you can see, many of us have they, them in our Zoom screen. It's a very easy change. You can change it to the pronouns. And when we get to the roundtable, if you'd like me to demonstrate how to do that, we can certainly do that. But again, first and foremost, lets people know how you identify. Because if you look at me now, you could maybe make an assumption that I am expressing as a man, So you would use he, him pronouns by natural, I don't say natural, but by teaching, right? Because we have been taught these pronouns since we've been very little. So you, it's not your fault that you look at me and you automatically think, you know, he, him. You wouldn't know until otherwise told. And that's exactly what I'm doing through my Zoom screen. So with that said, you can also put your pronouns there so other people know how to address you properly and create that sense of belonging. We'll talk about inclusive language in a couple more slides. And then at the other side, you'll see the hello, address me as. That's exactly what you saw me demonstrate in the beginning with they, them, theirs pronoun. And as you can see, the other pronouns thereafter. Now, again, APA 7th edition, they require us to use they, them, theirs, the first one, for all of us in certain circumstances, but they do not use Z and Z, which are the latter two. Now, if you want to, in your professional career beyond academia, you certainly can use those pronouns as well in your writing. So let's look at some skills up opportunities. So in front of you, you'll see an actual submission of one of my students, and one of my students was in a course with me, and they were writing about, as you can see here, they were writing about a theorist. And so they were choosing to write about Mesereau. And Mesereau, they continued on to say his, and you could see where I have the don't, right? So obviously I didn't put this in their feedback. That's just here for the presentation today. And what we do at National University is we teach through a pedagogy of teaching through engagement, which I absolutely love. So we engage with the student and we are here to teach them how to elevate. And in this case, I'm elevating their scholarly writing. So as you can see, the track change gives a lot of resources to use to see why I'm telling the student to change their language or their writing from gender specific binary pronouns to gender neutral pronouns. So all I did is give them a really nice, you know, call in, and I put the APA Basic 7th edition a gender from APA.org, singular they, APA.org. And then I linked them to some of the CTL webinars. But now we're doing skills up webinars, right? So this would be a great webinar to link in for the student to really see how they can use resources to implement gender neutral language in their writing. And then I just look forward to seeing it in the next week. But I also would like to take a pause here. I am a subject matter expert with LGBTQIAA+ framework and lens. So I look for this, right? So this is one thing that I look for with APA. Our faculty are very well versed with APA, but there's a lot of rules with APA. And so I'll be honest with you, when it comes to the resource page, the reference page, it's not really my best talent to really look at it and give you know, great feedback. I mean, I could see obviously the basics, but if I have to get really intricate with DOIs, I'll refer the student to the Academic Success Center. So my point is that we all bring different skills to the table when it comes to APA. So you may have a teacher, a faculty member that does not really give you these resources or lets you use a gender specific binary pronoun, but that's okay too, right? Because then you might get into my class or into, I know Dr. Broderick is on, but into Dr. Broderick's class. And we look for this to really help you elevate your scholarly writing. So I just wanted to put that caveat out there as well. So I also had a student who went through my course, and then in the next course, they used gender neutral pronouns. And the faculty member said, oh, this isn't grammarly correct. You need to use his or him. And so the student reached out to me and they said, you know, Dr. Gary, how do I navigate this space? And I said, you know, why don't you do this? Why don't you just use some of the resources and have a collaboration with your faculty member and show them you know, why you're using it. And so they did exactly that. And a few days later, I got an email that said that they were amazed at how open the faculty member was. And I also got an email from that faculty member that said, thank you, Dr. Gary. This was a great learning experience for both the student and I. And so I really loved that, that we are in a collaborative learning environment. So we want to call in versus call out, whether we're a faculty member or whether we're a student. We're on, you know, we're in this together. We're in the learning environment to really push language forward and writing to be more inclusive. Now that I've given you a little sneak peek, I wanted to introduce you to my book chapter. My book chapter in a book titled Motivation and Momentum in Adult Online Education. And we proudly have one of the editors here today, Dr. Broderick, and many chapter writers, authors in the Zoom today as well. So shout out to them. And I also was one of those authors. And the title of my chapter was Creating an Inclusive and Motivating E-Learning Environment for LGBTQIA+ Students in Higher Education. And can I take a pause there for a second? So the LGBTQIAA+ is a very long acronym. And even you saw me stumble, and I belong to the community and I'm a subject matter expert. So give yourself some grace if you can't LGBTQIAA+ right off the tip of your tongue. In scholarly writing, we narrow it down to LGBTQ+. So as long as you, you know, really have that plus there or LGBTQ, you will be okay. So I also want to kind of bring that out because many people say to me, oh, Dr. Gary, that's so long. I'm uncomfortable to say it. I'm afraid to get it wrong. Well, sometimes practice doesn't make perfect. Perfect practice does. So just making sure that you feel comfortable to practice and be wrong sometimes. And again, have a friend, you know, call you in and say, oh, you almost had it, but tweak it a little bit this way. And you could say, thank you so much for letting me know, and I'll do better next time. So let's do a little bit of a practice here. And I quote myself, which is very, very odd. It's the first time I've done it, but this is something that I wrote in the chapter, which was the concept of circumlocution is being utilized in an effort to be more inclusive to all individuals, those who comfortably fit the binary system and those who do not. And that's from me. And I wanted to say this very, very clear, comfortably fit the binary system. So some people, even on the Zoom, they comfortably fit in the binary system, and that's okay. We're not asking that we do away with the binary gender system. We're just asking it to be more inclusive. And if you don't know how that person identifies, please don't make that assumption, right? Ask them or start out by saying, hi, my name is Emily and my gender pronouns are she, her, which then opens the door for the next person to identify their gender pronouns. So why don't we take this exercise? I'm sure you are looking at this screen, and we're gonna play a little bit with circumlocution. And Dr. Broderick is on. And Dr. Broderick was my chair when I was at National University, and we're in the system. And she really introduced this to me and taught me how to circumlocute. Can I say that, Dr. Broderick? I know you're out there. Can we turn that into a verb? But she is an awesome linguistics person and has great knowledge, and it's a privilege to work with her. And we came up with some exercises, and here's one of them. So if you see the gender binary, which is on one side, which is a fixed mindset because we have been taught the gender binary, and to circumlocute these words into gender neutral words or phrases with a growth mindset. So as you look at that, what do you think? You could come off mute if you want to and pop in, or you could jot them down. But what are some gender neutral ways that we can say boys and girls, or military men and women, God, and addressing a group?
And Dr. Gary, we can also pop them in the chat as well, too.
So yeah, pop them in the chat.
Feel free to brainstorm, share some ideas. This is a welcoming space. So I'll just give a few minutes here. Okay, so great suggestion. For the first one, boys and girls, Dr. Gary, children was suggested.
Children, oh, perfect. Yes, Linda, yes, children's great. For boys and girls, good.
Students.
Here they come, students. Yeah, friends. Oh, I like friends. I think friends could be for ladies and gentlemen too. Like, welcome, friends. I like that one, friends. I
keep seeing some students, friends. I like to mention learners. And there's that too. They're actively engaging in that. Parents and guardians. Ooh, like that for the husband and wife, parents.
Parents and guardians, yes. And Kayla, is that, if I'm saying it correctly, you can come off mute as well. Brother and sister is in the gender binary system, but you could say sibling for it to be gender neutral. So my siblings, they introduced me as sibling, but how about aunt and uncle? That's a fun one. That's and it goes with brother and sister with the sibling. So it's a fun one. Wait till we get there. Elders, yes. Elders, relatives. Yes, relatives, good. Yeah.
I haven't seen any suggestions yet, and these are great suggestions so far. But what about military men and women? Service members.
Service members, yeah. Yeah, so I think that's good. Great. Oh, there's still some coming in, so I don't want to, cadets.
Yes,
military personnel. Good, Linda. Service providers. I like service providers because that could be more inclusive to, you know, EMS, medical field, right? Service providers. Yeah, educators, non-gender also. Yeah. Yeah, you know what? I actually started a speech. That's really funny, Faith, that you say that. So I did the speech at my community college graduation as the student speaker. And I said, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and non-gender identifying people. And everyone was like, wait, what? And so, it just sparked a lot of questions. People afterwards were like, what did you say after, ladies and gentlemen? And I was able to take the opportunity to really engage in an educational conversation with them. And most people are like, oh my gosh, that's excellent. Like, wow, I never thought of it that way. Same thing with they, them. I always err on the side of caution and use they, them. And people will be like, wait, what are you saying? And I'm like, oh, they, them is a gender neutral pronoun. And they're like, oh, I go by she, her. Or some people will say, what is the gender pronoun? And then I'll say, oh, she, her, you know, she, her, he, him. And they'll go, oh, no, I'm he, him. And I go, thank you for letting me know. I'll use that. And I go by they, them. And they're like, oh, my gosh, that's amazing. Again, it's just a gentle way to call in and not call out, right? So let's go ahead. I like the guys one. Anyone for guys? Like, we do that so much in groups. Like, hey, guys, come over here. Or, hey, good afternoon, guys. Like, it's just in our vernacular that we use guys so much. Did anyone, instead of, addressing a group as, hey, guys, hey, team, love, hey, team. Yes, Dr. Ida. Oh, yes. Welcome. Colleagues. Perfect. Yes.
Everyone.
Fellows. Oh, yeah. Hey, y'all. Okay. I think y'all passed that one. Hello, y'all. Yeah. Southern y'all. Perfect. Good. All right. I think you get it. Yeah. And this is in my book chapter. So you can certainly give my book chapter and have fun with, you know, your colleagues, with your family, and ask them, say, you know, hey, fill this out for me. What you know, I want to see where your mindset is. And there's a growth mindset. And I always like to talk about the heart set as well, right? So there's a fixed heart set and a growth heart set. And I always feel like it starts with the heart, because language and writing, these skills have been implemented in us since elementary school, probably before that, right? Probably while we were in the womb. Maybe, I know you couldn't see the gender reveal color because you were in the belly, but somebody might've been like, oh, look at the baby girl. They already started speaking to you through the womb. And that already starts recordings, right? So we we were birthed into the binary system, if you will. So, you know, you really want to forgive yourself if you're make a mistake. But that's where I talk about the heart set. So many people come up to me and say, Dr. Gary, I keep making this mistake. And I said, yeah, it's your mind, because you've been taught this. It's not your heart. So your heart, where's your heart at? Does your heart want to understand why we use they, them, and want to be inclusive with gender pronouns? I don't know. I can't, I'm not there yet. And I go, okay, when your heart is there and you're ready to learn, let's have a conversation. So it starts with the heart first. The mind will follow thereafter. So, you know, and again, it's really important to say, you know what, if I do misgender somebody, which I misgender myself all the time, and I have to apologize to myself, but instead of apologizing, I'll just say, thank you for letting me know. I'll do better next time, because it can be considered a microaggression. And when you use a microaggression by accident, whether it's in writing or in person, you have to remember that the person who is the receiver of the microaggression is actually the victim. And I really don't like the word victim, but they are the person who had the transgression toward, right? So you have to remember that first, because what happens is the sender will be like, oh, I'm so sorry, which then puts the receiver on a little bit of edge, like, oh God, they're sorry. That means they think they did something really wrong. And then they start to say, oh, well, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to make you feel that way. And then we're in this apologetic cycle, which is not productive. So if you do make a mistake, it's okay. And if you do have somebody who says, excuse me, my gender pronouns are they, them, or ze, zer, and you misgendered them, really own that and say, you know, thank you for letting me know, and I will do better next time. And make that commitment to yourself that you will do better next time. So let's go to the next slide.
Dr. Gary, yes. I have to interject, because this is like right on topic from what you're discussing right now. And it's a great question in the Q&A, if you don't mind.
No, I love it. Okay. Yep, this should be interactive.
Yes, absolutely. So and you're kind of on this topic. You were talking about, what does your heart say, right? And you're having that conversation when you're trying to figure out if you were misgendered and how to navigate that conversation in a productive, friendly way. So the question in the Q&A is, what advice do you have for calling people in who say some of these gender binary fixed phrases? I don't want to embarrass anyone by suggesting that they use more inclusive language. Similarly, I wonder how you address students who might be angered by the requirement to use inclusive language. And I'm wondering if you can just share some of your thoughts about that.
I love it. And, you know, I think it's real, right? Like, I think that question is rooted in real stuff out there. Mm-hmm. And let me unpack it a couple of different ways. So again, going back to that heart set, certainly I have many students, I'll start out with my experience first. I have many students from National University that are from the South or from, you know, all over, and they immediately address me as sir, right? And I say to them, you know, so-and-so, Emily, I can see you can use your name. I'll say, Emily, thank you for using sir for me, because I know you're doing it out of respect. That's what we've been taught. However, you know, I am gender neutral, so just call me by my name instead of using sir, and just call me Dr. Gary. Or students will say, oh, okay, thank you, Mr. Walker. And I'll say, oh, you know, I'm gender neutral, so if you could do me a favor and just use doctor before, you know, instead of Mr., say, you know, Dr. Gary's fine, and you'll never be, you know, you'll never be incorrect. And they'll say, okay, thank you, so sorry. And then I'll talk about the apologetic side. Nope. And I say, you know what, you might be wrong more in this class, but that's okay, because the more you practice it after you leave here, you'll be better. And most of the time at the doctoral level, I have superintendents, I have teachers, chancellors. So they're very high level, and they go, you know what? My students are holding me accountable. Thank you for letting me practice in your class. And I say, absolutely. So that's how I handle it from a teacher-student point of view. Now, I am from a generation, if you look at me, that I'm comfortable with the body that I'm in sometimes. So I got used to it. I didn't have the resources that today young generation has, like TikTok and you know, gender affirming care, right? I didn't know what that was. I ran home and watched Donahue and Maury Povich. I mean, that was my extension to understanding that there were multiple genders out there, and it was in a very negative, salacious way, right? So that was my exposure. So the younger generation, I'll give you a prime example. Writing the book chapter, I said, oh, you know, for my K-12 students, I said, oh, let's talk about this. Look at this chapter. And I was using preferred pronouns, right, in the book chapter. And one of the students called me in and said, hey, Dr. Gary, like, you know, we don't say preferred pronouns anymore. And I said, we don't say preferred pronouns or names? And they said, no, it's correct. It's our correct pronoun. It's our correct name, right, versus our dead name or our dead pronoun. And I say, oh, okay. So language matters, words matters. Preferred makes you think that I prefer this, but if you don't want to do it, then you can, you know, you can fall back onto the binary system. So I changed I called Dr. Broderick. I said, oh my God, I have to change the chapter. And we were going to, you're ready to, you know, publish. And I was able to make that change. And I made the change quickly to make sure that I was being inclusive to the new younger generation. So I too had to listen, right? So I think it goes back ways. Know when to listen and learn and say, okay. And know when to have a comfortable conversation. The last piece I'll talk about, Emma, is like in a professional setting, right? Like I think Dr. Broderick and I did this, and it's one of the resources I give at the end, but we do like a role play. Like if, you know, you're in a Zoom room with your boss or in now that we're back in person, if you're in a meeting and you know somebody's gender pronoun and the boss continuously misgenders them throughout the meeting, do you as an ally say, excuse me, like, oh, you're misgendering somebody? Because that's a boss. There's a power struggle there, right? They have power. They have agency over you at that moment, because that's just the way, you know, corporate America and education is set up. So those are, you get to make that comfort call, I call it. It's a comfort call. Do you feel that it's appropriate to, you know, say that right then and there? Or do you reach out to the person and say, I noticed that they were doing this. Would you like me to say something? Or would you feel most comfortable emailing the boss afterwards, so it's not on the spot making somebody look bad, right? So I think you got to kind of look at the situation and see where you could make that change in the most effective way for a good outcome.
Dr. Gary, thank you so much for sharing your advice on that. I often have heard you have conversation and kind of when it's like, maybe it's a little bit of a difficult situation, just navigating that space, but I've often heard you use the phrase call in instead of call out.
Yep.
And I think that helps provide a softer landing space, I guess I would say, to have an honest dialogue and a welcoming dialogue. Anyway, that's thank right. you so much for your thoughts.
Yeah, I learned from, you know, Dr. Tom Stewart, who was the VP of SJEDI, who will still be in the new SJEDI Council. Like, you know, educating with grace. I love the word grace. So educating with grace, and again, knowing where the heart set is. But here's the thing: don't get me wrong. If somebody is purposefully misgendering somebody, it can create a very dangerous situation. So if you can tell, or, you know, you have a conversation and they just say, look, no, this is the way it is. And we know people out there, this is the way it is. I'm not doing that. No. Then you pull in the right people and you say, you know what, that's not right. And we're going to elevate this. And you cannot make an uncomfortable situation for somebody. So that's very important to also know when the right time to really get the right authority involved to make sure that somebody is feeling belonged, feeling included, and feeling like it's a safe space. So be on the lookout for that as well. I know I do a lot of celebration, but there's a lot of advocacy that, you know, you have to really be strong and stern in your convictions. All right. So here's the answer key. So I hope you were looking at it, right? So I think we got a lot of these, like students, folks, right? Like everyone, partner, spouse, aunt, uncle, pibbling. I love it. Like, so I am pibbling, like for my niece and nephews, which they taught me. So I'm pibbling Gary to them. And so I really like that. And in writing, you could use pibbling, but these are the preferred gender neutral scholarly writing words that you could use when you're doing your scholarly writing. How'd you all do out there? Good? How'd everyone do? Awesome. Some thumbs up would be good. Yeah, awesome. Good. All right, well, let's move on to the next slide. And again, I want to give you some resources to navigate our academic space, but there are some ways out there through YouTube and Google if you're with your family or whatnot, or beyond the academic realm. But the Academic Success Center has self-regulating resources, and I want to show you those. And they also have the academic writer embedded right on that page. So as you can see, I have it in four quadrants here. So let's start at the first quadrant where you're going to click on APA style. So if you can leave and you want to go to your NCU1 homepage, go to resources, find the Academic Success Center. That's where this first page is, right? So you're going to click on the APA style. And then I also want to click or draw your attention to the academic writer as well. So they both kind of link APA guidelines. Then you're going to hit inclusive language, which is on a tab, blue tab on the left-hand side. When you click there, you're going to see gender pop up, race and ethnic identity, and sexual orientation. So you see all three of those. Today, I'm really focusing on gender. Maybe in the future, we could look at other ways to make sure that our scholarly writing is inclusive through race and sexuality. And then bam, once you hit gender, you'll see the academic writer pops up. And then you'll see some wonderful bullet points, but these are some guidelines. But this is the academic writer has a whole, like, it's almost like the LinkedIn learnings, but you could do a whole learning and go through the modules to ensure that you are, up on all of the gender neutral language and how to use them in your academic writing and speaking abilities. So I want to zoom in though to the academic writer, and here are some bullet points of nuances that where I want to kind of talk about whether you're in your coursework or if you're in dissertation. So I think we got it now. The APA requires that we use the singular they, but to represent he or she in the gender non-binary situations, but using the phrase he or she, right? Like use it sparingly or avoid. And only, oh, this is a very interesting one. I want to show you this nuance. And only if the person being referred to uses the he or she pronouns. Okay, so let's look at that caveat in a second, or that nuance as a caveat, and then do not use the he, she like that, okay? So I wanted to bring your attention to it. I think we already saw in the previous exercise from my student that when you're talking about a theorist or you're talking about somebody who you never personally were able to say, you know, what are your gender pronouns, or ask that question, you always default to they, them, right? But here is a situation in an e-course, which was Educating a Diversity of Learners, ED7009, where we ask for a journal entry. So sometimes the course prompt really asks you to get personal, right? And I did ask the student for permission to use this, but I still have confidentiality here. But this is their journal entry. And you could see that they're using gender pronouns. And who are they using gender pronouns for? Their mother, their father. These are very intimate relatives to them, right? So I'm going to, as an educator, as a teacher, know that, okay, they know how their mother or their father identifies with a gender pronoun. So I do not use that same link of track change to references in a journal dialogue or a journal entry, only when it's in academic scholarly writing. And here's where it flexes out during your dissertation. You get to do a section where you are giving accolades or, oh Lord, it escapes me right now. What is it called, Dr. Broderick?
Acknowledgements.
Dr. Sammy, acknowledgements. Yes, in your acknowledgements, thank you, Dr. Broderick, you're always there for me. In your acknowledgement, you can get very personal and intimate. And yes, you could use gender specific pronouns there, because if you're talking about your mother or your father that identify in the gender binary system, it's okay. But it's okay also in journal entries or when you're talking about your personal life and you know who they are. All right. So I wanted to kind of bring those few nuances up and how they flex out in the dissertation. I also look at dissertations as a chair and SME. And really, when you're talking about your theorist in the theoretical framework or your conceptual framework, who are the seminal authors or that really are behind those works, we use name, right, instead. So we would use the last name versus a gender pronoun. But, you know, have that conversation with your chair. If you're like, you know, Homans, every sentence starts out with Homans, you're going to want to, you know, really look at how to create some variations there. But talk to your chair about the gender pronoun in circumstances like that. The other nuance is in your dissertation, right? So I pulled one of my active students now as a gender neutral option for your dissertation. And this student is choosing to use gender neutral pseudonyms, right? That gives an extra layer of confidentiality. Such names like Kelly, Pat, Blake, Avery. So I thought that was very, very advanced, right? With their language and their skill writing abilities. So I love that. Also, we're looking at, you know, when you are doing the quotes, right? Direct quotes in section 3 or chapter 4, you know, certainly, are we using gender pronouns there? Did you ask all of your participants what their gender pronouns were? Did you give them an option on your survey to mark gender neutral or, you know, transgender? Like, did you give that option or did you only give the binary? Think about that as well. When you do the table that gives the demographics, how does that look? Do we really even need gender, right, as a demographic in your dissertation? I don't know, maybe not. If it's not specific on a gender problem or topic, then I don't know, is it necessary? So, you know, these are ways that you could advance your writing to be gender neutral in your dissertation. And I want to leave you with this. I feel confident you have the power to write inclusively in your scholarly writing. You've got this. And this is a wonderful quote, just as I started out with one. And this one is, you have the tools, right? I showed you those tools in the Academic Success Center at your disposal as a writer to shift the paradigm of what gets labeled as important. No longer are we leaving it to the linguistics or the English scholars. Use all of them to create the change writing, publishing, and our broader society needs. And this is Alita. Miranda Wolf. I think that's a very powerful. Writing holds power. You are becoming an academic, a scholarly writer, a published author, and therefore you have the ability to really help make our writing, our language, and our society more inclusive and a sense of belonging for all. And with that, I would like to leave a couple of resources for you before we get to the roundtable. And here are some books, What's Your Pronoun? And hot off the press, so exciting. I added that this morning, Courage to Change, authored by our very own student on today, Danny. So I'm so excited at the roundtable. Maybe Danny could talk a little bit about it. But also, you know, Dr. Broderick is one of the editors is on as well, creating an inclusive and motivation and momentum in adult online education. That was a recent publication from many national university faculty members. I know Dr. Galveo is out there as well, who wrote a fantastic chapter on inclusivity of English as a second language. We could have a whole skills up on that topic as well. And then I also have a YouTube link for educating practices for honoring identity and agency in academia. And yes, that is, our Emily right up in the corner hosting that webinar for us as well. So take a peek, take a look, but we're here for you. We are your safety net. We are your teachers to help you move writing scholarly with gender neutral terms and pronouns forward. So with that said, the last slide is the roundtable. So I would like to open it up. For the roundtable, I like to stop sharing so we could see each other. So we'll take the rest of the time, next 10 minutes, to do a roundtable discussion. So come on in and let's have a conversation.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Dr. Gary. I really appreciate it. And I have one question that did pop up, so I'd like to get to that first. And then, of course, if anyone does want to raise their hand and share a thought, we welcome all that. First of all, congratulations to Danielle on your recent publication.
Thank you.
That's wonderful. We always love to hear that awesome experiences for our students and our staff and faculty at NU. So one of the questions in the Q&A that came through, if someone has he, him, his after their name, the question is, how would you address that person in conversation? And then how would you address that person in academic writing?
Okay, so I would address them with those pronouns, right?
Correct.
So I would say, I would use them appropriately in dialogue and also in writing. So unless there's another nuance to that, just as I would with she, her, mm-hmm. and they, them, right? So that's how I would use it. And then what was the second part of that question?
Yeah, so if I'm Emily Springer and I've got she, her, those are my pronouns at the end of my name. When you are writing about me, do you write with she, her, or do you write with they, their?
And if we go back to, I know you, I personally know you. So I would use she, her, that is your correct pronoun. So I would always use the correct pronoun. Now, people that I never, know or heard of, I could assume that maybe President Obama goes by he, him, but I'm making that kind of assumption. I didn't get to call them up and say, hey, what's your pronouns? I'm going to be writing a book chapter about you. So, but if I was writing a book chapter, I probably would know him. But, if I were referencing them in a paper, I would definitely use gender neutral because I don't have that personal connection with that person.
Or just to kind of add on to the end of that, you could refer to that person by their name as well, too, right?
Is that where you're getting? Yes.
Yeah. So I thought it was a nice question because I think that this person's question just has to do with if someone does put the he, him, or she, her, are you also referring to their correct pronoun because of their preferences? And the answer is yes, you are. Yeah. You're going off of the person's their correct pronoun. I almost said preferred pronoun, but you brought me in today, so. Okay.
Yeah, name is always, Emily, you brought up a great point. Like name is always great. Like, so Jason, my husband, gets my pronouns incorrect all the time. So he's like, I'm just going to call you Gary. That works for me, babe. Like, that's fine. So the name or somebody who's like, I'm just not there, Dr. Gary, I'm not comfortable with the pronoun thing. And I say, then just use the first name every single time. Oh, that belongs to Gary. Oh, that belongs to Emily. Like, always use a first name, the or the doctor or whatever. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Dr. Gary.
That's a great point.
Dr. Gary, are you able to come off of mute?
Yes, I wanted to. Hey, thank you. This is great. I wanted to add on to that because I think, and I'm just making an assumption here, but part of it also is the respect. And you had mentioned it earlier, Dr. Gary, you have your doctorate. So it's easy to just throw out doctor and then we don't have to worry about the binary question, but people want to be respectful. So Mr., Mrs., Mix, Sir, Madam, I think that's another part of this question that mm-hmm. people struggle with a little bit. So if you could help with that, I think it would be helpful.
I love that, Dr. Garrett. And, you know, it happens to me all the time, as you can imagine, on flights, checking in. Sometimes I want to get into the education conversation. Sometimes I'm just too exhausted and I go with it because I know that I take it with best intentions. They're not trying to hurt me. They just are doing what we have been taught since we've been in the womb, right? Now, this is what I do. I print out my book chapter and I just slide it to them. And say, and it happened to me on this trip, actually. And I talked to the general manager at the hotel and I have already emailed them my book chapter. And they're like, oh my gosh, this is great. And I said, just change student to client, or, you know, somebody who's in the service industry, the purchaser or the person who's the customer. And then also change faculty member professor to the service provider. So you can still look at my chapter and apply it and transfer it into certainly the economic system of the United States of America, which, you know, we use ma'am and sir out of respect. So I'll just simply, you know, say, I get people who say, you know what, thank you for bringing that up. My daughter is holding me accountable. Like it opens such a great conversation. I have had some pushback where like, you know, like, well, I see you as a man. And I say, nope, I know, I get it, you know, but when you're ready, like, you know, here's my book chapter, like here, take a read or whatever. So I just gracefully give a resource or a reference that they can, but not all the time. I mean, I would be correcting people all the time. And I don't like to say correcting because then it makes them feel like they're wrong, which they aren't, because it's what they've been taught, right? So it's just a mind shift. So it's understanding that mind shift. So it's a great point. And again, if you feel unsafe, then I don't think that's time to be like, hey, you know, like you're, you know, being confrontational and escalating it to a point where you could be harmed.
And Dr. Garrett, thanks for bringing that up. I did want to mention that this person in the chat has just agreed with Dr. Gary on their last thoughts that they left with us about how writing holds power. And I just want to repeat this because it is in the chat and I think it's very important to do so. Glenda totally agrees with you. Writing holds and gives power. And as scholars and researchers in the field, the way that we write has an impact. And I just really appreciate you, Dr. Gary, bringing this to our series. And before we close, I know we're at time. Is there anything else that you would like to add before I wrap up today's session?
Yes, I know that we are at time, but if you could leave the Zoom on, if you want to stop the recording, so it is the time, but I would love to keep this roundtable conversation. Of course, we want to be respectful for the hard stop. So if you have to jump into another meeting or go to class or write a paper, we totally get it. But, you know, I think we have some great experts here, Dr. Broderick, Dr. Sammy, Dr. Garrett, Danielle. And you know, if we can continue, that would be great. But if you have to jump off, that's totally acceptable.
Absolutely. Okay, well then in the end of this recorded conversation, I do want to thank both of our ASL interpreters today. I'm so excited to see that we have that type of representation in our Skill Up series. And just keep in mind, we are always trying to provide tools, tips, strategies for academic success in your journey. So if you have a recommendation, my ears are open and my eyes are ready to read your email. So don't hesitate to reach us, send them our way. We are always looking to provide you with the tools you need to be successful in your journey.
And so, thank you so much for hosting us, Emily. You're always so graceful and guiding us through this.
Thank you so much, everyone. And I will go ahead and stop the recording. I hope you all have a lovely day.